In this lecture, I will explain how you can translate values into design requirements. To this end, we'll make use of a values hierarchy, which consists of three main levels. At the highest level, there are values. At the middle level, there are norms. And at the bottom level, there are design requirements. We will look at each level in more detail. First, values are things that we have reason to support because they are important, either for their own sake, or because we believe they contribute to other goals like a happy life, a good society, or a healthy environment. Examples of values that are relevant in design are human well-being, safety, security, sustainability, privacy, and justice. As we can see, values are usually referred to by quite general and abstract nouns. This is why they are relevant in many situations. However, this also means that they are often too abstract to directly guide a design project. Instead, they need to be translated into norms and design requirements. Norms are prescriptions and restrictions that guide our actions. They provide guidance about what actions and goals should or should not be part of the design process. Norms help to realize values. Examples of norms are principles and expectations like you should be honest or you should not waste resources. In design, norms are often described desirable ends we want to achieve, such as user information should only be shared if users have consented to it. Design requirements are the most concrete and specific level of the values hierarchy. They describe desirable characteristics of the design system. Design requirements are usually formulated at the start of the design process, but they may change and evolve during the process as new insights arise. It's often better to think of design requirements in terms of performance rather than in terms of hardware or software requirements, because this leaves open more possibilities to find alternative designs. Design requirements may be formulated as objectives that motivate a design, targets for the design to achieve, or thresholds that constrain the design. You can construct a value hierarchy with either a top-down or a bottom-up approach, or you can iteratively combine both approaches. I will start by explaining the top-down approach. The first step is to identify relevant values. Values are all around us. They influence all the choices we make. So it's not a question of whether values are present, but rather where to find them and how to recognize them. There are many relevant sources to derive values from. The design brief, the values of your client and stakeholders, your own values as designers, laws and regulations, technical codes and standards, ethical and social considerations, like those found in codes of conduct, and many other places. Once a list of values has been made, the next question is, what values should be included in the design? To answer this normative question, we should distinguish between intrinsic versus instrumental values. Intrinsic values are values that are valuable for their own sake. Some typical examples are human well-being, beauty, and truth. Instrumental values are valuable because they contribute to something else that is valuable. Typical examples in design are cost-effectiveness and reliability. Sometimes, values can be intrinsic and instrumental at the same time. Take, for example, the values of speed and efficiency. They clearly have an instrumental value, taking less time to travel and using less resources for the same outcome. Yet, some engineers also see these values as intrinsically good and desirable, not because of what they help us to achieve, but because of their own sake. Once the values are known, they have to be translated into norms. This can be done by asking the question, what would be a proper response to this value? This depends both on the value and the context. In the context of a beautiful painting, a proper response to beauty is to admire the painting. Here the norm is admire the painting. However, in the context of designing a building, a proper response might be design the building so that it is perceived as beautiful by its users. Values can have more than one proper response. Take safety. One norm in response would be design an absolutely safe system. However, in many cases, systems cannot be made absolutely safe, and therefore this norm might be too strict. One might also formulate the norm, meet the legal requirements with respect to safety. But in some situations, this may be an appropriate norm. In others, it might be too lenient. For example, because the safety regulations lag behind technological developments. A third possible norm might be make the system as safe as possible. Again, this may in some context be the appropriate norm. But if you know that making the system as safe as possible will, for instance, make the system too expensive or less sustainable, then it may be better to formulate the norm differently. Sometimes, one norm might be enough to properly respond to a value, but more often, we need several norms. The third step is to translate your norms into design requirements. Design requirements are a kind of norm, but they are more specific, formal guidelines for the system, object, or process you design. This usually entails things like specifying which values are most important, describing how and when they should manifest in the design, making general goals into concrete, measurable outcomes, and establishing the process that will be used to realize your design values and goals. The values hierarchy method I just described takes a top-down approach. However, you can also create a values hierarchy from the bottom up. In that case, you start with the design requirements, such as already chosen by clients or stakeholders. And then you work back from there by looking for the general norms that express those requirements and the values that underlie these redesign requirements. Making a value hierarchy will, in practice, often be an iterative process that combines top-down and bottom-up approaches. Redesigning a values hierarchy requires judgment, and there can be disagreement at every stage. Whether it is designing which values are relevant, or how they should be expressed by norms and translated into design requirements. A values hierarchy does not necessarily create disagreements. Rather, it is a method for clarifying the values, norms, and conflicts that are present in the design process for the purpose of helping you to make deliberate decisions about the motivations and goals that inform your design. Thanks for your attention.